All right, let's just begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. Just ask that you would open our hearts to understand and to learn from your word, your precious word, which you have written and preserved for us to teach us so much about yourself, your heart, and ourselves too. And so we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name, amen. Today, I'd like to do a study of King Jehu. King Jehu was the 10th king of divided Israel. He became king in about 841 BC, about 100 years after the death of Solomon. So I just told you he was the 10th king of the divided Israel. We may need to think a little bit on our history of the Jews, and so we can understand better what's going on. Saul was the first king of Israel. David was the second king. His son Solomon was the third king. And Solomon began very well, built the temple to God in Jerusalem. God came to him in a dream and said, "Solomon, whatever you want, I'll give it to you." And Solomon asked for wisdom instead of long life or riches. And Solomon did many things well. However, later in life, Solomon faltered. And he married too many women. And he accepted as brides many of the beautiful women from all the pagan nations that surrounded him. Because of the fame and the greatness of Solomon, they sent him their most beautiful women to be wives, which of course might help out in time of war too, but Solomon accepted these wives and he let his heart become swayed by them, and it says that he allowed them to worship their own gods. In fact, later in his life, Solomon built for his wives temples to these foreign gods. And in 1 Kings chapter 11, we read, "Now the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he did not observe what the Lord had commanded. So the Lord said to Solomon, 'Because you have done this and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father David, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away all the kingdom, but I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen.'" And unfortunately, even after these words, we do not have a recording of Solomon's repentance. And in the days of King Rehoboam, Solomon's son, the kingdom was indeed divided. And Jeroboam became the first king of divided Israel, the northern kingdom, 10 tribes, not including Judah and Benjamin, which remained with Rehoboam of the line of David. So Jehu became king about 100 years after the kingdom was divided in that way. Jehu was one of the kings of Israel, of the northern 10 tribes. And as a matter of fact, in the 100 years in the history of the divided kingdom of Israel, there have been no good kings. all of the kings were disobedient to God and were not worshiping him. And 36 years before Jehu became king, Ahab, son of Omri, became the king of Israel. And of course, Ahab is very famous for his wickedness. And he married Jezebel, the daughter of the king of Sidon. She was not a Jew, and she was a worshiper of Baal. And Ahab, just like Solomon, built for his wife a great temple to Baal in his capital city, which was Samaria, the capital of the northern 10 tribes. So in 2 Kings 9:25, and I want to mention this right now, because after Jehu had already become king, we read this statement, and there's something we need to learn from this. It says, "And Jehu said to Bidkar, his officer, 'Take him up and cast him into the property of the field of Naboth the Jezreelite. For I remember when you and I were riding together after Ahab his father, that the Lord laid this oracle against him.'" So what we learn from there is that Jehu was around in the days of Ahab. As a matter of fact, he was some type of officer or perhaps bodyguard, such that at the time that Ahab and Jezebel had Naboth killed to gain the vineyard, which he wanted so bad, that Jehu was right there in his presence when Elisha had come and delivered the oracle of judgment against Ahab. Jehu was right there. So, and we also know from further on in 2 Kings that Jehu was a commander, a captain of the army of Joram, which was Ahab's son. And so if we connect those two dots a little bit, we see that that Jehu was in service to Ahab in some type of high rank. And he was also in service as a captain to Ahab's son Joram and of the army. And so most likely, and we don't know the history in between that time period, but most likely Jehu being a very strong, very valiant man, and there being all kinds of wars going on at this time period, that he would have been in close service. How high? We don't know exactly when he became captain or so forth, but he would have been high up within in the service here of Ahab and his sons, with the army, with all the wars that were going on. And so one thing we can learn here then is we can look at some of the historical events that happened to Ahab and his sons and know that Jehu had a front row seat to that. He was right there. He heard this prophecy of Elijah against King Ahab. And there's a number of events that we know that Jehu would have witnessed. So what are some of these events? What are some of these things that Jehu would have observed actually many years before he actually became king? Well, the first event that he would have witnessed would have been the 3-year drought in Israel. When Elijah came to Ahab and said, by my word, there's going to be no rain in Israel. And then we know at the end of the 3 years that God sends Elijah back to Ahab, and he then challenges the 450 prophets of Baal to a test of power on Mount Carmel. And it says that all Israel gathered onto the mountain to see this great event. This contest of power, and we know that God sent fire down from heaven to consume the sacrifice which Elijah had put on the altar that he built on Mount Carmel, and then Elijah slew the 450 prophets of Baal, and most likely Jehu was on the mountain, right up there with all the rest of the people. I mean, it's possible he may not have been, but most likely he was right there on the mountain witnessing that event. As a matter of fact, just after that event, remember, then Jezebel becomes so enraged at Elijah that she sends the whole country on, stands the whole country on its ear and says, "Get me that man. he's going to die now." And Elijah runs away. He runs off into the wilderness, and God meets him there. God meets him on the mountain and speaks to Elijah. And a couple of things he tells him. He says, "There's a couple things you need to do now, Elijah. You need to anoint Elisha to become the prophet after you. You need to anoint Hazael to become king over Aram. And you need to anoint Jehu to become the next king of Israel." So that was all the way back there at just after the test of power on Mount Carmel, when the fire of God came down out of heaven. But Jehu was not anointed at that time, but Elijah was ready to do that when the time came by the word of God. shortly after, or sometime after that that test on Mount Carmel, we see that Ahab got into some wars and some battles. And his first battle, the Arameans then became a snare and a thorn, and coming after the Israelites and raiding the Israelites. In fact, if you remember, the little girl that Naaman had, she was one that had been captured from the raiding bands of Arameans that were coming and afflicting Israel. And so Aram went to war with Israel. Ahab went out to battle against him, and God decided to teach the king of Aram a lesson because the king of Aram was so arrogant. And God sent a prophet to Ahab at the battle, and he told him exactly how to engage the war, start the battle, and God delivered Israel and gave them a great victory against Aram. And again, Jehu, probably being in the service of the army, a valiant man, would have been right there witnessing that event. In 1 Kings chapter 20, we then read, at the turn of the year, just after this first defeat of the Arameans, the Arameans went up to Aphek to fight against Israel. And the sons of Israel were mustered and were provisioned and went to meet them under King Ahab. And the sons of Israel camped before them like two little flocks of goats. But the Arameans filled the country. Now, I'm not an expert in war, in ancient war, but I'm pretty sure you do not want to look like two little flocks of goats. I'm pretty confident of that, especially when the other guys fill the whole country. So here we've got Ahab and his army and Jehu and whoever else there, and not looking so good. Yeah. But a man of God came near and spoke to Ahab and said to him, "Thus says the Lord, because the Arameans have said, the Lord is a God of the mountains, but he's not a God of the valleys. Therefore, I will give all this great multitude into your hand, and you shall know that I am the Lord." So they camped 7 days, and on the seventh day the battle was joined, and the sons of Israel, these two flocks of goats, killed 100,000 foot soldiers of the Arameans in one day. Tremendous victory in battle due to the word of the prophet of God. Now, this battle is also significant because at the end of this battle, Ahab makes a fatal mistake. As they're slaughtering the Arameans and chasing after them, and Ben-Hadad, the king of Aram, is seeing that he's being closed in upon, he says, and sends out for peace to King Ahab and says, "You know what, I shouldn't have done this. Let's have peace. You can make streets in Damascus just like, you know, it'd be done in just like Solomon did." And so Ahab makes a covenant of peace with King Ben-Hadad of Aram. And in 1 Kings 20:42 we read, however, that a prophet came to Ahab and said to him, "Thus says the Lord to Ahab, because you have let go out of your hand the man whom I devoted for destruction, therefore your life shall go for his life and your people for his people." So the king of Israel went to his house sullen and vexed and came to Samaria. So God had actually planned to destroy Ben-Hadad through that battle. Ahab did not listen. He spared him, made a covenant of peace, and God said, "All right, yours for him then. That's it." Now, it was in this context that Ahab was so upset that he was walking through and saw Naboth's vineyard. And it was apparently a very nice vineyard, and he wanted it, and he was a king. And he asked Naboth for it, and he wouldn't give it because it was a family inheritance. And, of course, then Jezebel, his wife, said, "Oh, don't worry, honey, it's okay. I'll help you in that." So Jezebel went and falsely accused Naboth and his sons, had them killed. Ahab takes possession of the vineyard. And that is then where Elijah comes to the vineyard. As he comes to take possession, Jehu, we know from later on, was in accompaniment, and Elijah gives the oracle to Naboth, saying, "Thus says the Lord, in the place where the dogs licked up the blood of Naboth, the dogs will lick up your blood." And Elijah continued and said to him, "Because you have sold yourself to do evil in the sight of the Lord, I will bring evil upon you and utterly sweep you away, and will cut off from Ahab every male, both bond and free, in Israel. And I will make your house like the house of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha the son of Ahijah, because of the provocation with which you have provoked me to anger, and because you have made Israel sin. Of Jezebel also the Lord has spoken, saying this, 'The dogs will eat Jezebel in the district of Jezreel.' The one belonging to Ahab who dies in the city, the dogs will eat. The one who dies in the field, the birds of heaven will eat." Now it came about after these words, Ahab did repent. He says he tore his clothes, he put on sackcloth and fasted, and he lay in sackcloth and went about despondently. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah, saying, "Do you see how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself, I will not bring the evil in his days, but I will bring the evil upon his house in his son's days." And sure enough, 3 years later, Ahab goes to war against Aram again. He's wounded in battle. He dies in his chariot. They bring his chariot back to Samaria and wash the blood out of the chariot. And it says that the dogs licked up his blood according to the word of the Lord as he had spoken. So Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, became king next, not Jehu, because again, that was part of God's plan, but he said, I'll wait till the days of your son. So Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, became king. He reigned 2 years. He walked wickedly, just like Ahab did. It says, in the way of his father and in the way of his mother Jezebel. And in the second year of his reign, he fell through the lattice of his upper chamber and became ill. And in 2 Kings chapter 1, we read that he said, messengers, apparently he was quite ill, he said, sent messengers and said to them, "Go inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron," that's the Philistines, "whether or not I will recover from this sickness." And the angel of the Lord, however, at the same time, gave a message to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, "Go and meet the messengers of the king and say of Samaria, and say to them, 'Is it because there is no God in Israel that you are inquiring of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron? Now therefore, thus says the Lord, you shall not come down from the bed where you have gone up, but you will surely die.'" So Elijah departed, gave the message and departed. And the messengers returned to King Ahaziah, son of Ahab, and he said, "What are you doing back already? Why have you returned?" They said, "Well, a man came to meet us and said, 'Go give this message to the king,'" and they gave the message. And Ahaziah said, "Tell me about this man. What kind of a man was he?" And they said, "Well, he was a very hairy man, and he had a leather girdle about his loins." And he said, "Ah, it's Elijah." He knew him. I mean, you know. I mean, if you were in Israel at that time, you knew Elijah. He did a lot of things. Ahaziah knew just who this man was. And again, we don't know exactly where Jehu is at this point, but surely in part of the army service here. And so Ahaziah then sends a captain of 50 with his men of 50, and they find Elijah sitting at the top of a hill. And he said to him, "O man of God, thus says the king, come down." And Elijah replied to the captain of 50, "If I am a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven and burnt them up. So Ahaziah sent another captain of 50 with his 50. And he said to him, "O man of God, thus says the king, come down quickly." Not a good idea. Elijah replied to them, "If I am a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven and burnt them up. So again, Ahaziah sent the captain of a third 50 with his 50 men. And when this captain came up, he bowed down to Elijah. He went on his knees and he begged him and he said, "O man of God, please let my life and the lives of these 50 servants of yours be precious in your sight. Behold, fire came down from heaven and consumed the first two captains of 50, but let my life be precious in your sight, please. And the angel of the Lord said to Elijah, go down with him. Do not be afraid of this man. He will not harm you. And so Elijah went with this man, went to King Ahaziah and gave him the message, because you've inquired and ignored the Lord, you will surely die. So probably Jehu was higher up than these captains of 50s, but believe me, he knew this story. this was no secret, and by the time the third guy was going up the hill, he was thinking, well, okay, we got to have a different plan here. So anyway, Jehu would have known these captains, known these men. And surely known fairly firsthand about this story also. So anyhow, Ahaziah dies shortly thereafter, just as the Lord had spoken through Elijah. And Ahaziah had no son. And so Joram, which was one of the other sons of Ahab, became king in his place. And Joram reigned 12 years. It was Joram, for sure. We know that Jehu was a captain of Joram's army. Whether Joram had promoted him to captain, whether he was captain before, we don't know for sure. But anyhow, in a number of very significant events happened during the reign of Joram while Jehu was captain of the army. First of all, after just a short time, after Joram had become king, a man, Naaman, he was the captain of the king of Aram, who was their sworn enemy. However, Naaman comes to King Joram wanting to be cured of his leprosy. And it says that he handed the king a letter from Aram saying, please heal my captain. Well, he wouldn't want to do that in the first place, but... But because Israel was so much smaller and certainly under the shadow of the Arameans, King Joram reads the letter, tears his clothes, and says, am I God to kill and make alive that this man is sending to cure a man of his leprosy? Look, he's just trying to pick a fight with me. And it says it happened that when Elijah is gone, up to heaven in the chariot of fire. So when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent word to the king saying, why have you torn your clothes? Send him to me, and he will know that there's a God in Israel. So, Jehu would have known Naaman, one of his arch enemies of the captains of the Arameans, and everyone would have known of this great, tremendous healing that God did through Elisha to Naaman the leper. Shortly after that, then, the Arameans came to war against, thanks for healing my captain, but now we're gonna come and kill you. I guess we don't need anything else right now. So they've got these running battles, but the problem is Elisha keeps telling King Joram everything that King Ben-Hadad is going to do. And Ben-Hadad finally gets so upset and so frustrated, he says, all right, which one of us is for Israel? And they say, it's not us, it's Elisha. Elisha tells King Joram what you do in your bedroom. Don't blame us. So... King Ben-Hadad then sends to capture Elisha, because he would like to kill King Joram and gain control of the Israelites. So he sends the army to capture Elisha, and we know the story, right? They surround the city, and they wake up in the morning, and Elisha and his servant get up, and his servant wakes. He says, hey, the city's surrounded. They're all here. And Elisha says, Lord, open his eyes. And then he sees the chariots of fire of God all surrounding. And then Elisha blinds the whole entire army that had come out to capture him. He strikes them with blindness and leads them by the hand right into downtown Samaria. And King Joram comes to Elisha and he says, my father, shall I kill them? He said, would you kill those whom you have taken captive? Give them bread and water and let them go home. And Joram obeys. He does. He does what Elisha said. Again, Jehu would have been right there. He would have been right downtown with Joram when this Elisha leads the army in and sends them home. Right after this, it's amazing. One after another. Right after this, in 2 Kings chapter 7, again, Ben-Hadad comes and gathers his army and besieges the city of Samaria. And it says there was a great famine in Samaria, and so bad until a donkey's head was sold for 80 shekels of silver. And a fourth of a cab of dove's dung was sold for 5 shekels of silver. They were pretty hungry. And again, Elisha comes to Joram and he says to him, don't worry. This is the height. I mean, it can't get any worse, right? But he says, at this time tomorrow, a measure of fine flour will be sold for 1 shekel and 2 measures of barley for 1 shekel in the gate of Samaria. Impossible. And the royal officer, on whose hand the king leaned, answered the man of God and said, behold, if God should make windows in heaven, this could not be. And Elisha says, behold, you will see it with your eyes, but you will not eat of it. And at that very night, at twilight, 4 leprous men outside the city wall decided, you know, we're going to die. There's no food here. Let's just go over to the camp of the Arameans. And if they kill us, we're dead. If we stay here, we're dead. Let's just go. So they go, and they find the camp of the Arameans empty. And it says that God had caused the Arameans to hear the sound of chariots and horses so that they fled, leaving the entire camp as it was. And these lepers then went back and told King Joram, and the people went out and plundered the camp of the Arameans. They had just left everything and run. And sure enough, at that time then, a measure of fine flour was sold for a shekel and 2 measures of barley for a shekel. But the royal officer on whose hand the king had leaned was trampled by the people at the gate, and he died just as the man of God had said. And again, Jehu would have been in the city, in the famine, right there, probably knew this royal officer who was trampled by the word of Elisha. Jehu had tremendous witness of the power of God, of God's hand, of his workings, of his dealings with Israel. And so it was just after this event, basically, that we come to 2 Kings chapter 9. And Elisha the prophet calls one of the sons of the prophets and said to him, gird up your loins, take this flask of oil in your hand, and go to Ramoth-Gilead. And when you arrive there, search out Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, and go and bid him arise from among his brothers, and bring him to an inner room. And take this flask of oil, and pour it on his head, and say, thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel. Then open the door, and flee, and do not wait. So the young man, the servant of the prophet, went to Ramoth-Gilead, and he came to the captains of the army, and he said, I have a word for you, O captain. And Jehu said, for which one of us? And he said, for you, O captain. So he rose and went into the house, into an inner room. He poured oil on his head, and he said to him, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I have anointed you king over the people of the Lord, even over Israel. You shall strike the house of Ahab your master, that I may avenge the blood of my servants the prophets, the blood of all the servants of the Lord at the hand of Jezebel. For the whole house of Ahab shall perish, and I will cut off from Ahab every male person, both bond and free in Israel. And I will make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha. And the dogs will eat Jezebel in the territory of Jezreel, and none shall bury her. And he opened the door and fled. So Jehu comes out of the inner room, and his buddies go, this is the quote, why did this mad fellow come to you? apparently, you know, it was a dangerous mission and hyperventilating or what, but he appeared mad to these guys. And he says, well, you know the man and their talk. And they said, come on, tell us, what did he say? Jehu says, well, I'll tell you what he said. Thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel. And so his companions hurried, took off their garments, placed it under the king on the bare steps, and blew the trumpet, saying, Jehu is king. So then Jehu immediately goes and begins to conspire against Joram. And Joram had just gone to Jezreel. He had been injured in battle. He had and gone to Jezreel to recover. And so Jehu rides to Jezreel with all haste before word can get out of this conspiracy. And we know the story. The watchman stands in the tower and he says, I see a man coming. he says, send out a servant. He says, do you come for peace? Jehu says, get behind me. And they keep riding and he says, well, I don't know who it is for sure, but he's riding like Jehu because he drives crazy. And so King Joram makes ready his chariot. He goes out to meet Jehu. He wants to know from his captain what's going on, why this furious driving. And Jehu then confronts him. Joram realizes his life is in danger. He turns around. Jehu draws his bow with his full strength, shoots Joram between his arms. It goes through his heart, and he sank down into his chariot and died. And Jehu said to Bidkar, his officer, take him up and cast him into the property of the field of Naboth the Jezreelite, for I remember when you and I were riding together after Ahab his father, that the Lord laid this oracle against him. Surely I have seen yesterday the blood of Naboth and the blood of his sons, says the Lord, and I will repay you in this property, says the Lord. So take him down and cast him in the property according to the word of the Lord. And then the very next thing Jehu does, he rides straight off in search of Jezebel. Jezebel was the mother of Joram, you know, her a widow here now since Ahab is dead. And he comes to Jezebel and she sees him coming. Again, they know the driving of Jehu from a distance. And she decorates herself all up and she comes to the window, a tall window, and she says, Is all well with you, you murderer? And Jehu said, who's on my side? And three of the officers poked their head out, and he says, throw her down. And they did. They got her in their arms, threw her down, and her blood was sprinkled on the wall and on the horses, and Jehu trampled Jezebel under foot of the horses. And when he came in, he ate and drank, and he said, see now to this cursed woman and bury her, for she is a king's daughter. He forgot one part there, see. And go and bury her. But when they came out of the house after lunch to bury Jezebel, they found nothing more than the skull and the feet and the palms of her hands. And he said, ah, this is the word of the Lord, which he spoke to Elijah, saying, in the property of Jezreel, the dog shall eat the flesh of Jezebel, and that corpse of Jezebel will be as dung on the face of the field in the property of Jezreel, so they cannot say this is Jezebel. So she was not buried. Then Jehu went straightway and killed the other 70 sons of Ahab. And it says that he killed all who remained of the house of Ahab, all his great men and his acquaintances and his priests, until he left Ahab without a survivor, according to the word of the Lord. Now Jehu then gathered all the people. He's now king. Ahab's done, though. The royal line is gone. He gathers all the people together and he said, Ahab served Baal a little. Jehu will serve him much. So summon all the prophets of Baal and all his worshipers and all his priests. Let no one be missing, for I have a great sacrifice for Baal. Whoever is missing shall not live. But Jehu did this in cunning, so that he might destroy the worshipers of Baal. And Jehu said, sanctify a solemn assembly. And so they called, and he said, make sure that there's not one worshiper of Baal missing, because this is a very important sacrifice we're going to make to Baal here. And he brings them into the house, and then he says, within the temple, he's got men stationed outside, and he locks the doors. He said, now, this is such an important sacrifice to Baal, I want you to look around in the pews and make sure there's no servants of the Lord here, because this is very special. So they do that, and after they do that, he gives word to his officers, and they come and they kill all of them with the edge of the sword, and they brought out the sacred pillars of the house of Baal, and they burnt them, and they broke down the pillar and the house and the altar, and they made it a latrine as it is to this day. Thus Jehu eradicated Baal out of Israel. However, Jehu started so well. He did so much. He'd seen so much. However, as for the sins of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, which he made Israel to sin, from these Jehu did not depart. Even the golden calves that were at Bethel and Dan. And the Lord said to Jehu, because you have done well in executing what is right in my eyes, and have done to the house of Ahab according to all that was in my heart, your sons to the fourth generation shall sit on the throne of Israel. But Jehu was not careful to walk in the law of the Lord, the God of Israel, with all his heart. He did not depart from the sins of Jeroboam, which he made Israel to sin. Jehu, why? Why? Why would you do that? He knows better. What was the sin of Jeroboam that he did not depart from? We're going to have to do a real brief recap of Jeroboam. Jeroboam was the first king of the divided kingdom. He became king in the days of Rehoboam, Solomon's son. God sent the prophet Ahijah to give a special message to Jeroboam, similar to what they did with Jehu. Took him alone in the field, cut up his new cloak, brand new cloak, into 12 pieces, tells Jeroboam, take for yourself 10 pieces, for thus says the Lord, I'm going to tear the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon and give it to you. Because Solomon had forsaken me and have worshipped Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and Chemosh, the god of Moab, and Milcom, the god of Ammon, and they have not walked in my ways. And he says, I will take the kingdom from Rehoboam's hand and give it to you, Jeroboam, even 10 tribes. And he says, I will take you, Jeroboam, and you will reign over whatever you desire, and you will be king. And it will be that if you listen to all that I command, and you walk in my ways, and do what is right in my sight, and observe my statutes and commandments, as David did, then I will build for you, Jeroboam, an enduring house as I built for David, and I will give Israel to you. Amazing offer from God to Jeroboam. He says, I will build for you an enduring house just like I did for David. And God did fulfill his word to Jeroboam in that after Solomon died, Rehoboam was king, and he made Jeroboam king. But Jeroboam had decided he had a problem. There was going to be maybe one little problem here. And Jeroboam became afraid. He did not trust in the words of God, saying, I'm going to give this people to you, and I'm going to build for you an enduring house. Jeroboam said, the problem here is that we got two kingdoms now. But the temple's in Jerusalem. That's not in my land. And if the people keep going down to Jerusalem and the temple and worship, they might cozy up to Rehoboam again. They might decide they made a mistake in making me king. I might lose my kingdom. So he says in 1 Kings chapter 11 that Jeroboam said in his heart, "Now the kingdom will return to the house of David if the people go up and offer sacrifices to the Lord in Jerusalem." And so he consulted and he made two golden calves and he said to Israel, "It is too much to go to Jerusalem. Behold your gods, O Israel. These are the ones who brought you up from the land of Egypt." And he put one in Bethel and one in Dan. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship them. And he made high places and he made priests of anyone who wanted to be. And he instituted a feast in the eighth month on the 15th, just like the feasts which were in Judah. And on this inaugural feast, he goes up to the altar and he begins to burn the incense on this great, grand inaugural feast to the new gods, these calves of gold, to this new religion which he had instituted because he was afraid of his own personal prosperity. And as he goes up to the altar to burn the incense, a man of God comes from Judah by the word of the Lord. And as Jeroboam was standing on the altar, he cried against the altar by the word of the Lord and said, "O altar, altar, thus says the Lord, behold, a son shall be born to the house of David, Josiah by name, and on you he shall burn the sacrifice, he shall burn the bones of the priests, and human bones will be burnt on you." And he gave a sign that same day, saying, "This is the sign which the Lord has spoken. Behold, if I am telling the truth, this altar will be split apart and the ashes poured out." And when King Jeroboam hears the declaration of the man of God, he stretches out his arm in anger and he says, "Seize him!" And when he does that, it said God dried up his arm so that he could not draw it back. And then he got a little scared. And, you know, be tough to walk around the rest of your life like this. You know, it's hard enough to get through doors all the time. You know, imagine going down the sidewalk, "Excuse me, pardon me." So Jeroboam says to the man of God, "Please pray to God that he would heal my arm. And I won't kill you either." And the man of God prays. It's even hard to hold your hand up for a little while. And the man of God prays, and Jeroboam's arm is restored to him. The king says to him, "You know what? I'm going to give you a reward. Come and have, let's sit down and with a meal." And the man of God says, "No, God told me I've got to leave here right away." So, anyhow, Jeroboam had some food for thought. Okay, that party was over. The altar split, okay? They couldn't even do the stuff. The altar broke apart and the ashes spilled out. You think he would consider, and he did. And you think he might repent, but he didn't. See, the problem is when you're king, you can do pretty much anything you want to do. You can have pretty much anything you want to have. Unless you have to listen to God and obey Him. I kind of cut short the get everything I want part. It also cut short the I can do anything I want part too. If you have to listen to God and you have to listen to His word and the law and the things that are right, and you got priests around saying, "Hey, you know, can't do that." Worshiping God and obeying Him kind of ruins the gratification of the flesh. So in 1 Kings 13:33 we read, "After this event, Jeroboam did not return from his evil way, but he again made priests of the high places from among all the people. All who would, he ordained to be priests of the high places. And this event became sin to the house of Jeroboam, even to blot it out and destroy it from off the face of the earth. It was bad enough that he made idols, and there were lots of kings that made idols. But Jeroboam knew better. His own right arm was a witness against him of the one true God and the power of God and the truth of God, and God does what he says. But he wanted what he wanted. He did not want to be constrained by the law of God. I'm sure it's nice being king and have anything you want and anything you want to do. Jeroboam later on had a son. His son became ill, and he loved his son, and he wanted to know what was going to happen to his son. So he tells his wife, disguise yourself and go to Judah, to the man of God, and inquire what's going to happen to our son. He didn't go to his own religion. He knew it was worthless. He invented it. He knew better. This was the sin of Jeroboam that Jehu walked in. Jehu knew the same thing. He knew better. He knew the power of God. He had seen the fire of God come down from heaven and burn up the sacrifice on the altar. But he didn't want a law of God that would constrain him. He didn't want to be reminded of his personal accountability before God. I believe this is the sin of Jeroboam. And it's the sin of Jehu. The thing about us is we're not that different from Jeroboam and Jehu. We know. We know the Bible. We know the miracles. We believe. We know that God exists. You know that evolution is a fairy tale, don't you? But the question is, what will you choose? A life of personal gratification to what you can do whatever you want to do? Or a life of worshiping God and obeying Him? The sad thing is the gratification of the flesh doesn't even really satisfy. Many will choose it. You know people who have chosen that. Beyond the truth of God's word in the Bible, which tells us of the emptiness of the passing pleasures of sin, all you have to do is just go read a biography of the rich and famous. They'll tell you it's empty. But some will still be tricked. I want what I want instead. I want the thing that's going to make me happy. I want the thing that is going to please me and give me pleasure. Howard Hughes was one of the richest men America has ever known. He was once asked, how much money would it take to make him happy? His response, just one more dollar. It's empty. They know. But will you choose? What will you do? King David, the man of God, said in Psalm chapter 84, one day in your courts, O God, is better than 1,000 days outside. That's the truth. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than to dwell in the rich tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. He gives grace and glory. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. That's the truth. Some things we think are good, but he will not withhold any good thing from those who walk uprightly. My challenge today is for us to choose God's way. Worship him, obey him.